Hello and welcome. We are really excited to be here at the Portland Retro Gaming Expo 2018. My name is Emily Rosenthal. I am honored to introduce to you your keynote speaker. Tommy Tallarico has been a 30-year veteran of the video game industry, as well as a lifelong and television fan. He is the visionary behind many and all of the exciting developments here at the newly formed Television Entertainment Corporation. Please put your hands together for a warm welcome for Tommy Tallarico.
Thank you. So lots of exciting things we've been working on within television. And the, folks ask me, what are you going to do? You got to do your big speech, the big reveal of the new console. Man, you got to do it at E3. That's the place to do it. I'm like, nah. And people are like, well, how about the Gamescom in Germany, biggest video game convention in the world? They're like, yeah, I can do it there. It's in August, end of August. But I wanted to do something special, and I said, you know what I want to do? I want to show how different the company is and how we think and how everyone, what folks like you mean to us. I said, you know what? I want to do it at the Portland Retro Gaming Expo, right here in Portland, Oregon. Yes. Because we have some amazing, amazing things that I think a lot of people in the room here will appreciate. So the main trailer and press release that we're doing is coming out Monday morning. And so I'm going to share the trailer with you here today, the reveal trailer. So you will literally be the first people in the world, besides the internal team working on it, who is going to see and find out all of this information. Like I said, I'm going to play the video and it's going to be released on Monday. So I would ask, when the video comes up, you can record any of this stuff that you want, but when the video comes up, I would just kindly ask for people not to record it and put it on the internet. So if you do me that favor, that'd be really special. I appreciate that. So let's start from the beginning. This is my street cred here. This is me playing in television in 1982. So, yes. Gotta love those big-ass TVs, right? My cat was watching. That was a good, great game of baseball that day. And so I was an Intellivision family. Christmas 1980, my mom got the system for us. Me and my dad were big sports fans, and younger brother. And, we're all gamers here, right? But when we were growing up, there was no such thing as a gamer. Because everybody played video games, right? And that's not the case anymore. And that's what we're going to really, really help change. But, some people used to take pictures of them and their friends. Some people would take pictures of them and their parents. I used to take pictures of me in video games. That's what I would do. That's me next to my television, and I would record photo finishes here, and there was like some Astro Smash competition that was going on, and of course I got my Astro Smash score and I sent it in. So I was as hardcore as you get, and in fact, there's a lot of negativity around gaming these days, mainstream media and stuff like that. Well, all video games are violent and video games cause this and that, and but I always say when I started my touring show, Video Games Live, that it's in fact quite the opposite. Video games inspire people. They inspire people to create art. You ever go on, some of the big sites like DeviantArt, you see hundreds of thousands of people creating art images. Just look at over here, all these amazing artists and stuff that are in the expo. They were inspired by video games. Cosplayers, see a couple cosplayers here. They created those costumes. Musicians, go to things like MAGFest. Also, video games, Twitch TV. 30 million people a day watch Twitch TV. Millions of people are creating content because they're inspired by video games. YouTubers, YouTube channels, journalists, everything because of our passion for video games. When I was a kid, I used to make, you know, I would keep all my statistics for all of my video games. I even learned BASIC up in the top right corner. So I wanted to learn how to program games, all because of my passion and love for video games. I used to keep scores of races. And then I would, at school, you know, I'd get in trouble because I was drawing Q-Bird, and you can see the Intellivision logo up in the top, even the M Network and iMagic. Check that out. I don't know what the hell that Atari logo was doing there. But anyway, I don't know. My friend must have put that on. That wasn't me. That wasn't me. Anyway, so, and I even, when I was, you know, 12 years old, I wrote a letter. I would write letters to game companies asking them, you know, what was the part of this game? And when I got stuck in this one game, Temple of Apshai. I don't know if anyone ever played that. A couple of you, yeah. So I couldn't figure out like how the game ended, so I wrote a letter, you know, and they actually wrote me back, so that was cool. So, you know, writing, communicating skills were on full display there. So the new company. So can we all, I don't know how many people in here knew him personally or met him maybe at the conference, but he was a very dear friend of mine and the people who work at the company still, Keith Robinson. And Keith Robinson sadly passed away last summer, but Keith was the person who really kept Intellivision going over the last 20 years. Without Keith, I wouldn't be standing here talking about Intellivision now. And so I just wanted to, if we could all give a round of applause to Keith, because he's looking down right now. And he came here 4 years ago today, in fact. 4 years ago, he came to the Portland show and had a booth set up. And again, for those of you who knew him, biggest heart on the planet. Anyway, so company pillars. Our company pillars within television are very, very simple. They are simple, affordable, family, and fun. Those four things are the whole basis of this entire company. Now, three of those things are not being done in the home console world these days. Games aren't simple anymore for home consoles. They're not affordable, and they certainly don't revolve around the family. See, when I was growing up, like I said, when we were all growing up here, everyone played video games. I played with my mom, my dad, we'd go to the arcades. There was no such thing as a gamer because games were different back then. It was a more simple time. Anyone could pick up a game and you could teach them how to play within 10, 20 seconds, and everybody had fun and there was communication. I remember, you know, my mom, I'm 100% Italian, my mom would be in the kitchen making the sauce, and then we'd be playing some Intellivision skiing, me, my brother, and my dad. Hey, Mom, you're up. She'd put the wooden spoon down. She'd come over, get a little shot, go back, boom, boom. They were these simple, fun things. And we all gave each other crap. We'd make fun of each other. Hey, Dad, you suck. No, you suck. And there was this whole kind of family thing. Some nights we'd play Monopoly. Some nights we'd play Scrabble. You know, different things like that, aggravation, Yahtzee, and then most nights we also played in television though. It was something we did as a family. Where did that all go? Where did it all go? We're gonna bring it back, okay? So, we got, first of all, what's wrong with the game industry right now? What are all the current things wrong? Well, the first thing is that all games that are being made seem to be made for hardcore gamers. I walked around E3 this year, and every single game, even in the Nintendo area, every single game was like, you know, targeted to hardcore gamers. I was thinking to myself, and my mom and dad are still alive, if they were coming in here, there wouldn't be a single solitary game that any of them would play. Not a single one, right? The controllers are intimidating, the menu screens, everything about gaming. And with esports, it's just getting worse, right? Because now, you know, the companies are trying to make as many little, you know, different things that they can. What gives one player a little bit better, you know, position over another player? So they keep constantly coming up with more and more things to make games complicated. So I see that as a huge problem. And as big as the game industry is and the growth that it's getting, it's still only a little small section of what it could be if you cater to or interested in having non-gamers and families come back into gaming like it used to be in the late 70s and early 80s. So all the games are for hardcore gamers, it seems. And the other thing, you keep going there, is the controls and the controllers. I cannot put a PlayStation 4 control in my dad's hands and say, here, dad, go for it, right? You can show the thing. I mean, this is just a typical game for the PlayStation 4. This is all the stuff. And again, even the Nintendo stuff, like the Nintendo Switch. Put a Nintendo Switch controller in your mom's hand and say, here's Zelda Breath of the Wild, Mom, go for it. Right? Not going to go well, I can tell you this. I don't know, you know, dual analog sticks with my parents, they're just, you know, they're always either pointing up here or they're pointing down here. They just don't get the whole, you know. And so you can keep going too. I mean, show some of this stuff. I mean, this is just the Xbox. Typical games for the Xbox, PlayStation. Keep going. It gets. Don't even talk about PC now. You get into PC, and it's a whole other different nightmare. For non-gamers, right? A lot of people in the room, we get this stuff. And then there's, of course, the system menus and options. I had my dad. I said, Dad, could you turn on the PlayStation 4? Just turn it on. Has anyone who's a non-gamer tried to turn on a PlayStation 4? You can't even turn the thing on. It's like you got there's a touch thing, and if you're in the dark, forget it. My dad couldn't turn the damn thing on. And then you get into the menu screens, forget it. Does the thing even play games anymore? I don't know. You know? A lot of people ask me, is the new machine, are you going to stream Netflix? And you're like, no! My refrigerator streams Netflix now. I'm not joking. I bought a new fridge. It has a screen on it. I could watch Netflix while I'm cooking the... No, we're not streaming Netflix, people, okay? Maybe we will someday. No, I'm just kidding. If they pay me us $1 million, no. So this is the thing. We're about simple, simple, simple. This is crazy. Now, again, I don't want to stand up here and sound like I'm, you know, crapping all over Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo. I'm not. I'm a huge gamer. You know, I loved Spider-Man, getting ready for Red Dead Redemption 2. I love these systems, right? But I'm a hardcore gamer. What we're talking about is all the other people in the world. The video game industry has freaking tunnel vision right now, right? And it has for over 12 years. It's all the, boom, it's this. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna expand to the world. Okay, let's get, what else we got here? Unfair and unbalanced gameplay. This one really gets me the most. You talk to a lot of people who don't play video games anymore, and the reason is because it's too difficult to get into. You know, games are, it's too difficult, the learning curve's too much. I can't sit down and play with Fortnite with my kid. It's not even fun. It's not even fun to me anymore, right? So here's a typical, I mean, it's unfair, but this is me and Paul Nerman playing a game of Utopia. I'm the one on the left. And this is a typical game. So it's really unfair, but keep going with that. So we're doing something about that as well. It also takes too damn long to play video games these days anymore, right? It's just, you know, okay, so I'm 50 years old, and when I play a game now, God of War 4, a Spider-Man game, you put 20, 30 hours into this thing, I gotta be honest with you, not to leave this room, I actually feel guilty, you know? I'm like, oh my God, I could have built a shed, I could have learned a language, I could have spent time with the dogs, my wife, we could have went on a trip. You know, you almost start to feel guilty when the older you get. You don't have 30, 40 hours to dedicate to games anymore, right? And so, you know, but you do have time to spend with your family. You don't feel guilty. If you've spent 20 or 30 hours that week having fun with your family, spending time with your kids, communicating, bringing your friends over and having a good time, this and that. Well, now that's something that you don't feel guilty about. That's something that you want to encourage, right? I mean, you talk about cell phones now. There's a whole generation of kids, teenagers and younger, they grew up with video games as their babysitter. Their parents handed them a phone or handed them a tablet, iPad, to shut them up, right? And so they learn, you know, the long car ride, or they're in a restaurant. Now those same parents will complain to me, saying, oh, geez, he never gets off that thing. Well, you were the one who gave it to him in the first place, you know? And so why not be able to play with them? Oh, I don't understand those things. I just give them that to shut up and this and that, and I want to keep quiet, give them something to do. You know, so it's become this solitary thing. It was never like that when we were growing up, right? We played together as friends. And now I went to the Sony booth at E3 and I got the whole virtual reality thing. I mean, you should see it. It was a little scary. You know, people with the headsets on, they were all carrying guns. It looked just like that scene out of Ready Player One. It was just like that. So even the whole like VR craze, which is probably going down the tubes quick now, but the whole VR thing is like, you know, again, solitary experiences. You can talk about, well, there's multiplayer gameplay online. I'm sorry, it's different. When you're in a room with people, it's very different. It's the difference between listening to music in the headphones and going to a concert and hearing it in real life, right? So anyway, so you say, well, Tommy, all the stuff you're talking about, isn't that just like mobile gaming? Like mobile gaming's for everyone and for kids. And if you look at the mobile gaming market, it's exploding, right? But the problem with mobile gaming, there's a lot of issues with it. I mean, first of all, once again, it's a solitary experience. It's you in a phone. And let's face it, all the games that us retro players love out there, have you ever tried to play them on a phone? Can you play Pac-Man on your phone? Your finger's right in the way. You're trying to steer this Pac-Man with, you know, that'd be like playing Call of Duty with your arm in front of your face. That's equivalent of what it's like to play a game on a cell phone, you know? So there's that. It's a solitary experience. The controls aren't there. And let's face it, 97% of all mobile games are crap. They're crap. Fart app. How many fart apps can you have on one cell phone? It's amazing. And they're always trying to what? They're trying to get your credit card to sell you 10,000 gold coins for 99 cents. Or they're trying to get your Facebook profile, your email address, or they're blasting you with video ads to make, you know, ad revenue there. They want your friends list on Facebook, all that stuff, right? It's just, whenever I download a game, I'm just waiting for it. Here it comes. Where's the money grab? Where's the scam? You know, so it doesn't feel, and again, they're all very kind of, you know, these short pieces of game, like where you're only playing for like 3 minutes, 5 minutes, waiting for the bus, waiting for the plane, or whatever. So a lot of problems with gaming as well, mobile gaming as well. This was a really interesting thing that came out for the researcher, NDP group put this out. But you'll notice that it talks about how mobile games have been, you know, a key segment for the games industry. But in there it says the real potential for growth lies with getting the other groups increasingly involved in gaming across platforms that they may not have considered using for gaming in the past, right? So again, this whole kind of home console thing, something that's part of the family, which brings us to the Wii. So, and you can hit the next one here. So the Wii, I tried to get the craziest pictures I could. And I gotta tell you, it wasn't hard. There's a lot. Now, what the Wii did successfully, you say, well, Tommy, this whole idea of non-gamers buying a game console for the home seems crazy to me. Well, it's not so crazy because 12 years ago, Nintendo's already done this. They've already proven that, you know, they've proven that non-gamers will absolutely buy a home video game console if it's something that's fun and simple, right? My mom has bought 2 video game consoles her entire life. Christmas in 1980, she bought an Intellivision for us. And then 12 years ago, she bought a Wii for herself. And her and my aunts and uncles, they'd get together, they'd cork open some wine, and they'd go bowling, right? Here's where Nintendo, I think, dropped the ball a little bit. Is that 103 million units of the Nintendo Wii were sold, the third biggest selling home console ever of all time. That was sold. And Wii Sports, the number four selling video game ever of all time. Obviously, it was a pack-in and this and that. But let's face it, Wii Sports was nothing more than a tech demo. Am I right? You know, you could swing a bat, you could play some tennis, you could, you know, bowl a few rounds. So that should tell us something. Tetris is the number one selling game in the world. Yeah? Very simple, right? Accessible for everyone. And where Nintendo, I felt, dropped the ball is that, and I've spoken to people at Nintendo about this very thing. And what they'll tell you is, you know, they kind of caught lightning in a bottle. They were trying to get away from what Sony and Microsoft was doing. So they said, you know what, let's just come up with something totally left field. Let's do the whole, you know, controller thing. And they came out and it was amazing. They never really thought that they would sell to so many non-gamers. And Nintendo, they made games. Nintendo knows how to make games for their fan base. That's what they do. That's why they're a $40 billion company, right? They're amazing at what they do. They make games for their Nintendo fan base. That's what they do best. So as soon as the Wii came out, where'd you go? Let's do a Super Smash Brothers. Let's do another Pikmin. Let's do another, you know, Mario this and a Zelda that and a boom, boom, boom. And it's the same kind of thing. So they went right back to their wheelhouse. They went back to making it. They never made games for my mom again after that, right? I mean, they came out with the Wii Fit, and the Wii Fit was cool. But they never really catered to non-gamers because that's not what they do. They're not in the market to do that. They love, you know, they do what they do great. They do it better than most people in the world. And so, and then some of the other third parties tried to do some stuff, but it was all shovelware, and it really sucked. So, again, there's no quality control. Where's the quality control? That's one thing that we're doing different from everyone else. So, what I'd like to do right now is I want to show you our four-minute trailer that we've come up with. We've been spending the last couple weeks on. It's going to show you the system for the very first time, what it looks like, and the name of it, and a whole bunch of information. And what I did for this show, because we're at the retro show, I'm gonna be sharing with you a bunch of games that are retro games that we're gonna be completely remaking for a whole new generation of people, and I'll get into that in a second. But if out of respect for us, if anyone could please not record this, if there's any cameras going, if you could just shut it off for the next 4 minutes, that would really, really help us out a lot. Because this is gonna hit on Monday morning, but we wanted to do something special for the folks here in the room today. So you're the first ones in the world to see this, so enjoy.
Thank you.
right, so let me go through a few of these things with you. And you can turn your cameras back on at this point. So the system is called the Amico, the Intellivision Amico. Amico is the Italian word for friend or buddy. And so that's our approach to this whole thing. You'll notice that this is a system that we designed with parents and grandparents in mind, as well as gamers as well. We're looking at the finish for this. We're looking at a, it's like a pearlescent white metallic, but with a matte finish. If any of you are familiar with the new Teslas, the Model 3s that just came out, they have a matte white metallic. It's very similar to what we're doing with. That's a silver brushed kind of aluminum around the, all the silver parts that you see in that as well. I'll talk a little bit more about the lighting as we go to the next one. That's it from the top. So, as a nod to the original Intellivision, we have the controllers fit back in to the system itself. We thought that would kind of be a cool thing to replicate. But what that also enables us to do is we're also, the controllers are going to be Qi. So wireless, it's spelled QI, but it's pronounced Qi. Qi, the wireless charging. No other video game console has ever done that. So once you're done playing, you put the thing, and they're gonna like, it's gonna be magnetic, and they kind of like snap back into place, and it'll be charging wirelessly the controller for you whenever you're not playing. So it's, it goes back on the home base itself. You'll notice to the side some of the lights and stuff, and we'll go to the next slide. I'll show you, I'll tell you a little bit more about this, because the pictures really don't do it justice at all. So what we're doing is we have this Intellivision Prism onboard interactive lighting. And what that is it's basically going to be, and you can easily shut this on or off with a switch on the console itself, but what it is we want to bring people, you know, feel like we're bringing them more into the game experience themselves. So, you know, you go, sometimes you go to these strip malls or whatever, and you go into these games, and the lights go off, and it blows wind in your face, and maybe some of them spit water at you, or stuff like that. So it's that whole kind of vibe. One thing that I learned with doing video games live is that just having a symphony on stage playing video game music and showing a screen of the game, that was pretty darn cool. But as soon as you bring in that lighting, that rock and roll lighting, now it becomes something entirely different. So imagine if you could for a second that, and the other thing, sorry, is that we want the console to feel alive, like it is your friend, like it's rewarding you. So, you know, something that, you know, like if you take like a Tamagotchi or a Furby, remember those, right? It's just circuit boards and wires. But you kind of felt emotionally connected to those things. It kind of felt like, you know, it was understanding you, it was a little alive, it was giving you, you know, things. So we want to kind of bring that vibe into the whole home console, because all the rest of the home consoles are just, they're just like, you know, black rectangles, bricks, right? And so we want this to kind of come alive a little bit. So with the lighting, imagine, for example, and I'm not saying that any of these games are being made for the system, but I'm just to give you an example. Think of like a game like Metal Gear Solid, right? And you're sneaking around, and as soon as, you know, and the you get caught, and the, you know, the exclamation point goes over your head. Imagine if, you know, the siren kind of went off in your home as well. You know, red lights. So these are very, very powerful lights, and that's kind of what the pictures don't show. They're very, so it can look like a little mini rock concert, or it can make it look subtle as well, diffused and subtle. So we have different kinds of lights that we're doing with inside and around the console. So this is more of like the diffused, just kind of like cool look, but it can be used in gameplay as well. Imagine you're playing Intellivision baseball or boxing, and you knock a guy down or you hit a home run, and there's like, you know, it's like replicates like camera flashes or something. Or maybe a game like APB, or you're, you know, there's a police chasing you and it's going red, blue, red, blue, red, blue, or something simple like you beat a level in Tetris and it lights up a rainbow or something like that as well. There's also an LED all the way, LED strips all the way around the controller itself too, around the disc also. So as you're playing different things, the disc can also light up as well. We'll see that in the next one. And again, these are conceptual designs, and these are about 80% there right now. But so it's a 3.5-inch, 3x2 color touchscreen, similar to the original iPhones that came out. You'll see the disc itself has a little bit of a dish curve into it. One of the things that I didn't like about the original Intellivision controller is that the disc, when you tilted it down, it had that, you know, hard plastic ridge all the way around it, and that's what actually hurt, you know, when you would play for hours on end. So we completely got rid of that, and it's actually raised up a bit, and so when you push it all the way down, it's actually flush, so there's nothing to get in your way. It's actually, you know, completely flush like that as well. The wireless Bluetooth controllers, this is going to be pretty crazy. Like the video said, there's a speaker on there, there's a microphone on there. We have gyro and accelerometers, so you can, you know, and you'll be able to turn it any single way you want. So we're all used to using the Intellivision straight up, because it had the telephone cable at the top and you couldn't use it any other way. But now you can actually turn it sideways and play with, you know, that way as well. Or if you're left or right hand dominant, you can turn it all the way up. So you can play it. You can even turn it all the way upside down and play like Coleco, you know? So there's a whole bunch of different ways that you can play with the thing. You keep going on there. There's the gyroscope, the accelerometer, the Qi charging, which I spoke about as well. I think it's really super important. I don't know how many times, you know, I'll play my PlayStation 4 and the thing will be, I end up playing it wired half the time anyway, because I always forget to, you know, charge my stuff or whatever. But it's like the little details too. See how there's a little running man on the on-off switch, and all the stuff will be lit up with LEDs. And yeah, and so this is really exciting. So the controllers, you can do up to 8 controllers can connect to the device. So if you wanted to, you could go, you know, obviously we'll be selling you'll have the controllers that can be sold separately. So you could buy the ones with the disc and the buttons and everything like that. But let's say you had, you know, 4 or 5 friends over. Normally what people do is they play charades or they'll bring out Pictionary. No one brings out their video game console, and if they do, it's, again, a multiplayer game is passing the controller around, right? Well, what fun is that for the other 4 people? And again, if people are non-gamers, they're just kind of watching anyway. They're not getting into it. So what we're doing is you're going to be able to download a free app on your phone. Not charging people. We want people to do this. They can download the app. So let's say a game like, and we're going to replicate the controller. Now, obviously, it's not going to be as good, right, as having that disc that actually tilts, having those tactile feedback, you know, buttons and all that stuff, force feedback that it's going to have as well, too. But what it'll do is, for a simple game, like let's say you're playing a game of Tetris or a game of You Don't Know Jack, some kind of trivia game or this and that, where you only need to really hit the button or something, we want to open this up to everyone. So you have some friends over, you only have 2 controllers, hey, check it out, and now you can play as a group, right? And you're not having the cost of actually having 8 controllers. We want 8 people in a room to play together. Right? They don't necessarily going to have to buy 8 controllers to do that. That's insane. So it's going to be a free app. Okay, next one. Next slide here. All games are E for everyone or E10 plus. There is no violent games on this system. Not a single one. Yes, clap. That's good. Let the others do that. I'll tell you a quick story. For the last 30 years, every single one of us in this room who are gamers. We probably have friends who've never played a video game, and they'll call you up and they'll say, you play games a lot. What game should I get for my kids? What system? I want to get them a system. And for the last 30 years, what have you told them? Nintendo, right? That's what you do. Well, I got to tell you a story. Last Christmas, same thing happened to me. A woman three doors down, Christian family. And she says, she goes, Tommy, I know you're in the video game industry. You know, we have a 7-year-old, a 10-year-old. What do I get them for Christmas? I want to buy them a video game console. I said, you get them the Nintendo Switch. That's what you do. Okay, thanks, cool. I get a call in March. And she says, Tommy, I thought you said this was for kids. I said, yeah, it's Nintendo. It's the one for kids. She goes, I walked in the living room. There's blood all over the screen. I'm like, what game are they playing? She's like, this Resident Evil thing? I don't know what the hell it is. So you got to remember, see, all of us are gamers in this room, right? But you got to remember that middle America or non-gamers, they don't know that the Nintendo Switch has a parental control thing. Oh, by the way, you have to go in the menu. You have to figure it out. You got to set it up. They don't know what the ESRB is, the Entertainment Rating Software Board. They're not paying attention. They call me up. They say, what game, what system should I get, Nintendo? They go to Walmart. They get it on Amazon. Whatever they do, they wrap it up. They put it under the tree. They're done. They're out, right? They don't even set it up. So what we're doing is, we're creating a system that parents want to buy, not because they were asked to buy, right? And that's a really powerful thing. So every game, rated E for everyone, they never have to worry about it, ever again. You buy an Intellivision, you never have to worry about it. And the other thing too, a powerful statement, all games are console exclusive. Now this is a little gray area. Does that mean we're not going to have Tetris? Does that mean, well, Tommy, we saw Burger Time, we saw all these games up there. You'll be able to get those on other systems, maybe, but not the way you're going to get them on our system. Every game, we're not doing any ports. No ports on our system. Don't want them. The others can do them. I don't care, right? I go on Nintendo Switch now, and there's so much stuff up there. When did quantity take over for quality? When did that happen? Why is it the system with the most games is the coolest or something? I don't understand that. Cell phones are a joke, right? There's so much crap on there. It takes me hours just to find something good. Steam, Nintendo, the PlayStation stuff. There's so much, like, I don't care about quantity. We really don't. I'd rather have 20 awesome above average games than 100 mediocre ones. Remember that Nintendo seal of quality? Remember that? In the 80s? You knew when you bought a game and you saw that thing, you knew it was awesome, right? What the hell ever happened to that? What happened to that? In fact, by the end of the NES's life cycle, that had gone away. I know, I worked on some of those crappy games. Anyway, go see Coloring Dinosaur on the NES, you'll see. No seal of approval on that one. So we're going to bring that back. Such a simple concept. Keep the games great, keep them high quality, or else they don't go on the system, that's all. That's fine. And we're going to do everything in our power to make sure that we're going to get those games to be as great as possible. And we keep saying this internally, I know this is a subjective thing, but if it isn't at least a 7 out of 10 on the scale, it's not going on the system. We're not gonna put it out, you know? So, yeah, simple. And that's the whole quality control here. We thought we'd give a nod to, for those of you who are Intellivision fans, the Blue Sky Rangers was the code name for the folks who worked at Intellivision back in the late 70s, early 80s. It was a TV Guide, the TV Guide article and interview that came out. And anyway, they were codenamed Blue Sky Rangers because they didn't want people to get poached. You know, it was a very with Atari and Intellivision going at each other's throats all the time. So it was something that that they kind of came up with. So we thought we'd bring that name over as kind of a nod to our legacy. Keep going on. Balanced gameplay and design. I call it equal opportunity gaming. So this is exactly what I was talking about earlier, you know? Let me give you a couple examples, though, of how the simplest of ideas can start to spawn whole other design ideas and things like this. Let's take the game Pong, for example, which we are remaking. We are remaking Pong. And let's say that I'm really good at Pong. And, you know, the person I'm playing is playing it for the first time, right? So again, this is the mentality I want designers to think about, and developers and publishers, is if I score 3 times in a row on that, you know, on the other person, then my paddle shrinks and theirs expands. It's that kind of thinking. Why not have, when is the most fun that you have playing games is when it's kind of even, right? Where somebody's almost gonna, you know, oh, that's the best fun, the best loud, the best laughs, the best jabbing of the other person is when you're so close all the, right, all the time. Modern gaming, that's very difficult. Very difficult. That's kind of gone away, right? That whole thing. So we're going to bring it back. I'll give you another example, another easy example. Let's take a game like Tetris. Let's say there's 4 people and we're all playing Tetris on the same screen. We all got our columns. You can do that on 16 by 9 now. Let's say there's 4 columns. And again, I'm really good and the other 3 people are playing it for the first time. They're not as good as me, this and that. Every time they complete a row, we actually enable them. They can throw the blocks onto my side if they want. Right? So again, real simple concept, Tetris, but equalizing it. And if so, if they wanted to gang up on me, they could, or if I could convince my younger brother, hey, stop ganging up on me, let's gang up on mom, let's screw her over, you know. And then, and that's when games, see, communication, being in the room with the people, that's what we want to, you know, we got to bring that back. And now, are we going to have, you know, one player action adventure games? Sure. You know, a game like Night Stalker is a perfect example, right? It's single player. But wait a second. Why couldn't we have 2 players? Why couldn't you have 2 players in Night Stalker? Now we got 16 by 9 screen. You know, it can get a lot bigger. Same thing with Astro Smash. Why not put a second one in there? Now you're competing for points. Night Stalker, you could stun somebody with their gun and then they freeze. You know, and then, oh, and then the panic ensues as the robots, you know, kind of come in on them. So, anyway, we'll keep going with that. That's right, you are reading that correct. Every game in the store, $2.99 to $7.99. Download only. Yeah. You know the difference? The difference is this, it's all download only, right? And you know what? We're passing all of the savings on to the end users, onto the customers, right? Isn't it funny that you can spend like $70 on a downloadable game on the Nintendo or Sony or Microsoft or whatever? You can spend $70 on a download game. Well, wait a second, they didn't have any cost of goods. They didn't have manufacturing. They didn't have to do the, you know, they didn't have to ship it out. They didn't have to hit a middleman. There wasn't 100% markup in the stores, right? So what we've done is we just said, you know what, we're going to pass all the savings onto the folks. And that's really important for us. Now, a lot of people have said, yeah, but you know, we like our physical material. I do too. I mean, look at going out there and seeing the old Intellivision cartridges or some of the old boxes and stuff like that. That's so cool. So we're not going to abandon you. Don't worry. What we're doing is that those are going to be like similar games. Like if you play a game like Undertale, for example, for those, you know, Undertale, it was a downloadable, it was a Kickstarter project, Toby Fox, they do a great, you know, great, amazing thing. And it got so popular that people wanted physical copies of the game. And so they did, you know, special limited edition, gold foil, signed, numbered, whatever. So we'll do those as well. So you'll get a, you know, if you want to pay $20 or $30, for a box, we're gonna make it special though. We're going to put in a special poster signed by the designer of the game or special numbered only copy, this and that. So we want to make sure that that $30 of value, you actually feel it, right? But if you want to, you know, collect something and put it on your wall or whatever, we're going to allow that too as well. But we'll do it direct with you guys, right? So again, we don't have to, it's not going to be a $60 or $70 product. And also we might do some exclusive. We're talking to like Amazon and Walmart right now about, you know, Amazon will get a special version of Astro Smash, whatever. You know, you can only get it through Amazon. But again, always the price is really low. Keep going. Time and space leaderboard system. What the heck is that? So we want to do, what we're doing with, what I mean by time and space is that the leaderboard systems are kind of cool. You know, you go on there and say, oh, boy, I really kicked butt. Let me see where I stand. Oh, I'm 45th, 5,000 in the world. I suck. Okay, I thought I was good. And so what we're going to do is you're going to be able to see the leaderboard systems based on time, meaning all time, yearly, monthly, weekly, right? So where are you this week? Where is your score this month? Right? And then also based on space, meaning country, world, state, province, city, things like that, right? So your little sister might be the lead score for Astro Smash for the week of October 15th in the state of Oregon. That could be possible, right? So again, just to make you feel a little bit more, so we're gonna break it down. You're gonna be able to see all the different, oh, where am I in the world? Oh, wow, I'm 30th, you know, whatever. So we're gonna have that. Now the rewards, the trophy and achievement awards, there's nothing that bugs me more. It's like, you know, again, you're playing God Awards, like you've just killed 1,000 people. Here's your trophy, you know? And, or you just won a certain race. The problem with trophies and achievement awards on the modern consoles is that everybody can get one. Anyone can get one of those. How many people got this thing before I did? Maybe 1 million people? Okay, I got that level, now I got this one, now I got this one. You know, and you work your way up. And see, we want to do something completely different, which is to say, we want, if you get an achievement or award, we want it to be unique to you. So we're gonna base it on the time and space leaderboard system. So if you get the high score of the month of October in the state of California, boom, that's your trophy, that's your award, and you're the only person in the world that has that. That makes you feel, you know, that's something that you're kind of proud of and kind of, and we're even talking now about, you know, sending somebody a certificate, you know, email that they can print out and put on their wall. Right? Remember the old days, we're thinking, you know, maybe if you do it, like if you're the high score in your country, maybe we send you a patch, like the old days, like they did. Remember, that was fun? Yeah. Wouldn't it be cool to collect patches and stuff like that? You know, what else we got? Tournaments. So one of the things, so not only online tournament modes, but local tournament modes as well. I know, like when I played GoldenEye, when that was the thing, right? And all our friends, we'd bring 8 friends over, and we'd play 4-player split screen. We would literally come up with tournaments. We do it ourselves on paper. How many people have done that with friends, playing games? It could be anything. Oh, who's going to win in Pac-Man, this and that. And like, we're going to build that into all of our games. So if you want to set up a 5-player, whatever, double elimination match of Shark, you'll be able to do that right in all the games. It's, you know, and of course we're also going to be able to do that online as well. So competing all the time, even in the simplest of games, Pong, Asteroids, Space Invaders, whatever it is, you know, you'll be able to compete with other people around the world if you so please, or set up tournaments right there in your home, and it'll, you know, do all the math and everything for you. The store, we have the online store. That's where all the games will be purchased. We're going to do something cool too to kind of give a nod to the old television stuff, which is, remember the television games, they had the boxes depending on the box colors, depending on what. So all the sports games were blue, All the action games were red. There was the gambling games were green. The education, I think, were orange. Orange, math, fun, and all that. Board games were purple. So we're gonna carry over that color system into our store as well. So if you if you want a sports game, the blue tab, sports, boom, and it's all the sports games. So you'll be able to kind of go through the store and by categories. You are reading that correctly. You are reading that correctly. Again, Sony, Microsoft, they actually lose money on their hardware. They lose money, those machines are incredible and amazing pieces of hardware, and they lose money on them because they make the money, in the software, right? But the reason they lose so much money is because they're these like massive, amazing computers that have all this incredible processing power and everything. We're not going that route. Now, again, we're not putting a Raspberry Pi or an Arduino in there. We are a hardware company. We have electrical engineers on staff creating hardware for us, right? And have been for months. That is what we're doing, right? So we're not outsourcing anything like that, And so we feel that in order to really get parents excited, and to get families and non-gamers to buy something, look, the Nintendo Wii was $249. My mom spent $249 and never bought another game. She spent $249 to go bowling. Amazing, right? And most people who bought a Wii, I'm sure you all know people who bought a Wii to go bowling and they never bought another game after, or maybe they bought the Wii Fit or something, right? So that is the price point that we're going for. Now you say $149 to $179, does that mean there's gonna be different price? No, I said that because I wanted to give people a number in the range that we're trying to hit, right? So it will be somewhere in between there. We're hoping for $149. But this gives me a little bit of room, because if we come up with something so cool or some new technology hits in 6 months from now, we gotta get it in the system and it's gonna cost us $10 more to make, well, I don't wanna not do that and say, oh geez, I told those people a year ago it was gonna be $149 or whatever. So we're giving ourselves a little room, but I just wanted to tell people the price range that we're looking at. Under $200, way under $200. Next. So the new games that we're doing, the reimagined games, updated graphics. See, we did a lot of research, and you play some of the old Intellivision games or the Atari games, Coleco games, even some of the NES stuff, and you start to lose younger people around the late 80s. The graphics in the late 80s, anything late 80s or before, you're starting to get into the territory where a teenager is like, ah, that's a block to me. Now they don't mind graphics. Again, the game Undertale that I spoke about is, 16-bit style graphics, right? Look at Minecraft, second biggest selling game ever of all time. Bunch of blocks. Tetris, squares. So graphics, don't matter in the bigger picture of things, but we want to update the graphics, and I got to tell you, some of the stuff I wish I could show. We're going to leak out. My PR and marketing folks hate me. They hate me because, Tommy saves himself. We got a whole, every month we got to, I want to tell you all everything right now, I'm just scratching the surface with some of this stuff, but some of the games that we're seeing on screen right now, they're like paintings. It's unbelievable. And it's all because they can focus on just this. They don't have to worry about this. When you just have a painting is 2D, folks. Right? Painting, 2D in reality, right? If you're drawing, it's a single plane, right? So yes, it looks 3D, but some of the stuff's incredible. So we're updating, but we're not gonna mess with the gameplay. We know what, I worked on the Tony Hawk, the original Tony Hawk game. I worked on the original Guitar Hero. And so from those huge games, I saw every year they would say, okay, what are we gonna add in Tony Hawk this year? I'm like, nothing. The game is fine. Just change the levels, change the graphics, change a little bit of the design, this and that. Don't add all these different, by the end of it, like, oh, you're on a board now, and they hook up the board to the Nintendo, and it just ruined it. Guitar Hero, the same thing, every year they come out with something, now we got this mode, now we got that mode, now it's too complicated for my dad to play again, you know, when he's not playing. And then I've been on the other end of that coin too. I worked on some of the Sonic games. The really crappy ones. So I saw the end of that, right? Where Sonic was a perfect game. 2D, roll the guy to the right. Collect some rings along the way. We're good. No, now we got to do this. Now we got to put him into 3D. Oh my God. I mean, by the time I got to the franchise, Sonic had a sword. Yeah. Sonic and the Black Knight. That's what I worked on. Not fun. We don't want to change the gameplay of all these things. We want to keep the gameplay mechanic. That's what made these things so much fun. But let's update the graphics to the 21st century. Let's update the audio. Instead of the bleeps and bloops, let's bring in some real sounds. Again, imagine a game like Night Stalker, right? Where it's kind of, you know, a gritty look and it's all, you know, looking good. Yeah, we can add some levels in there as well. We can put in multiplayer modes. Anyone want to play Night Stalker multiplayer? Online, different things like that, and a whole bunch more. But we don't want to change the gameplay mechanic. Very important. Okay? So, in television classics, all of the boxes that you see on that screen are being remade, reimagined. Everything from Frog Bog to Horse Racing, B-17 Bomber, Star Strike, Utopia, Baseball, Shark, Night Stalker, Star Strike, you name it, we're gonna reimagine it for the 21st century. And again, we're not messing with the gameplay mechanics. Okay? This next one is funny. Hilarious. So why not, right? Atari announced, of course, that they're coming out with the Atari box, they called it, then it was the Atari VCS. It's supposed to be out in July. I wish them luck. I love, people say to me, oh, you know, the original console wars. It was actually when we first announced we were doing another console, it was in USA Today. From USA Today, console wars are back 40 years later, Atari and Intellivision. So I'd like to have some fun with those guys. I hope we can have some fun together. You know, joking around, tongue in cheek, it would be fun to reignite the rivalry. I think it would be cool. But so this is me officially one-upping them out of the gates. So I contacted the Atari, the holding company, the main company, and I said, look, I'd like to redo all of the Atari classics. 5 minutes to the end? Holy crap. All right. I'd like to do, so much for Q&A. Anyway, I'd like to redo them all, but I want them, one condition, they have to be exclusive to Intellivision. So the way we make them will only be, you'll only be able to play these versions on Intellivision. They can put them on other systems. iMagic, any iMagic fans? Yes? People have been waiting for this for 30 years. We unlocked it, okay? We are the first people to get the rights back from iMagic, and we're redoing all of them. Microsurgeon, Beauty and the Beast, Truck in Atlantis, Dracula, we got them all. Next, we gotta start to move quick here. So Burger Time, big one, where's Johnny? Stand up, Johnny Turbo, ladies and gentlemen. He's the guy. Johnny, he worked for Sega, he worked for TurboGrafx, if you ever played any of those games. And so we're redoing a bunch of stuff exclusively for Intellivision. We're gonna redo them all. Some really good games. Next slide. All right, do we have any Moon Patrol fans in the audience? Yeah. 10-yard fight. R-Type, Kung Fu Master. Any fans of Lode Runner, Spelunker? Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce for the first time ever at any of these kind of conferences, Scott Tsumura, He was the very first person when Nintendo said, we gotta start an internal team. He started it. Nintendo of America, the internal team that did Wave Race 64, Ridge Racer, things like that. The Nintendo Software Technology, that's what they were called, their internal department. He was the president, Kemco president, was at MicroProse, Spectrum Holodeck president, but he was the producer of Moon Patrol, producer of all these things. And he's with Intellivision. Stand up, Scott. Here he is right here. Yes. We're gonna have 20 brand new games. Don't think of us just as a classic console. We're doing completely brand new stuff as well. We'll keep going. This man right here would like to stand up. Jason Enos, right? He is the producer. Castlevania, all the Metal Gear Solid games, Silent Hill, Dance Dance Revolution, Tekken, Pac-Man. This is the producer who's now working with Intellivision. Next up, Steve Roney. He's the guy, him and Keith kept the company going for so, so long. The original programmer, B-17 Bomber. Without him, this wouldn't exist at all. He was the guy who took Intellivision after Keith passed away, kept it alive. Big part. Where's Steve? Steve, stand up, Steve Roney! Bill Fisher, been with the company since 1981. Also did a lot of great stuff for Interplay as well, like Castles and Star Trek stuff, Conquest of the World. Please, Bill Fisher, stand up. Emily Rosenthal, she's amazing. She's been with the company for so, so long, over 10 years too. Really the keeper of all the knowledge and information. She's the one that keeps us going. Emily, stand up. Emily, there she is. Go say hi to your television first. And Paul, I've never met anyone who knows more about Intellivision games or retro games in my life than Paul, and so he's our VP of production for all of our retro stuff. Paul Nerman! Wanted to touch quickly on marketing. These two ladies, they were the ones who launched the Wii, they launched the Nintendo DS, and a whole bunch of other consoles. Karen Kaplan, Vice President of Marketing at Nintendo, she was there for about 18 years. Beth Llewellyn, Head of PR for 12 years. They are working with Intellivision. Hello. So there you go, developers. As far as developers, you say, well, Tommy, how do you get developers to create games for a system that has zero installed base? That's a great question. You know the answer is? Money. We're paying everyone to create games for us. No one has to take financial risk on their own at all. You bring us a game, we like it, we want it on our system, you have zero financial risk. We will pay you to create the game for us, and that just goes in advancement against royalties. I know there's a ton of questions that are gonna kick me out. So much I wanna talk about. We're gonna be at the booth tomorrow. Come by, say hi. If you wanna know when dev kits are coming, the answer to that's next summer, okay? So we got a lot of work ahead of us. I need everybody to go out there and spread the word. When this thing hits, please join our mailing list, intellivisionentertainment.com. We're gonna send you the official press release, which will have more information. We're gonna send you the video that's gonna have the video you saw here today. Please, you wanna help us out? If you believe in what we believe in and this vision that we have about gaming, please, please, please spread that trailer to as many people as possible. We want as many eyeballs on this thing as possible. If you guys see me walking around, please come up and ask me questions. We were supposed to do a Q&A, but it got a little crazy. And I know Walter Day is here, and he said he's going to come up. Walter, come on up.
Are familiar with Twin Galaxies. Yeah. Wonderful history video game. This is the gentleman that lives about an hour away from me who started that way back. And we wanted to commemorate what you are witnessing live.
It is a lie, isn't it?
It is.
Okay. So, a lot of you people know that I live in Fairfield, Iowa, a town of 10,000 people. And in that town, over 4,000 of the people practice transcendental meditation. So it's a really unusual community. And one of the things that they research there is all about creativity and intelligence and what really makes a Renaissance man. So I'm officially declaring that Tommy Tallarico is a Renaissance man. But he's got the words. He's got the music.
Too young.
No, you got plenty of time.
No lifetime achievement award yet.
But essentially, and a lot of you are actually Renaissance people too, because you have benefited these people so much with the intelligence, the creativity, the knowledge of computerized stuff, you know, music and words and lyrics and all sorts of fun things. So you really bring an incredible gift, not only to Intellivision, but to everybody who's in this community. And there's a lot more people out there who need to be honored. We should call it maybe the Tommy Tallarico Renaissance Award. No? But anyway, on behalf of all of us, we're giving him a trading card that commemorates him being up here, introducing this amazing new era of Intellivision greatness, and presenting it on a trading card.
All right.
And I had no idea there was going to be a turnout like this, so I already have like 100 cards. So you're going to have to get them autographed by Tommy and get them all to you so they don't have to be responsible for the autographs. But anyway, these are presented to you on behalf. These are presented to you on behalf of Old School Gamer Magazine that wanted this to happen, so they got this all together. And we're handing out more awards out at our booth at 160 to people like Tim Lapatino and all the people from the Tetris thing. So we have more awards tonight. But thank you
everybody for coming and having and listening to us. For us, it's all about passion. It's all about passion. We do this, you know, because we're passionate about it. And thank you all for coming out. And let me know if you have any questions around the conference this weekend. Thank you.